Today is Thursday, February 27th. It is this installment of the new reform school program from Choice Media. My name is Bob Bowden. Thank you for joining us. I, as usual, have on my right the great Brian Carr.
How y'all doing?
Yes. And Heather Kays at the
Hello.
Studio 2, which is another name for the corner. But more importantly, we have the great Neal McCluskey coming to us from the Cato Institute. And Neal, thanks for your time on today's reform school program. We appreciate it.
Hey, my pleasure.
All right. A lot in the news today, and you can see on the Choice Media website, which we have up here, Mississippi parents voicing support for special ed vouchers. This being, you know, vouchers, the term being used, and as people like Neal McCluskey know, this is actually an education savings account plan in Mississippi. But the point is, Arizona did it. Mississippi said, we can do it too. It'll be for special needs kids, at least at first. But this is a good program, and they're trying to do it, and I guess parents are coming out in support, Neal.
Oh, that's what it looks like. You know, there's always this problem of any school choice program if it involves your ability to choose a private school. I don't know whether it's intentional or unintentional, but the media has a tendency to call it all vouchers, whether it's driven by tax credits, you know, donations you get a tax credit for, whether it's an education savings account. And the problem with that, of course, is if you look at polling surveys, voucher is a term that doesn't poll nearly as well as things like educational freedom and education savings accounts or tax credits.
Yeah.
Often,
well, Neal, you know, yeah,
if
you're writing a headline for a newspaper, though, you can scarcely have the space to explain those distinctions, right? You do need a word to call these things, right?
Well, yeah, I would just say school choice.
That captures
what you're going
there
after
you go.
Without loading the term.
All right.
And voucher is actually deceptive. I mean, it's giving you bad information.
I know.
What you're really handing out is a voucher.
Now, turning back the school choice clock a couple of years, Cato came out strongly saying, we think tax credits is the way to go rather than vouchers. In this new education savings account realm, where do you stand on that?
Yeah, well, first of all, I have to say Cato doesn't have any opinions of its own. Only the people who work there have their own opinions. I am not against voucher programs, not against education savings accounts, not against tax credits. I have some questions about charters, but you know, I tend to like all choices. I think what's really important about the tax credits, and this problem still applies to an extent to education savings accounts, is with those programs, vouchers and education savings accounts, the money goes to the state, and then the state sends it to somebody. And they've run into legal issues, especially with state constitutions, where people say the state is in that way indirectly supporting religious institutions.
Sure, Blaine Amendments.
I think that's a dubious argument, but it has held up, and the tax credits tend to avoid that problem.
Right. Well, let's move to the more conventional educational realm for a moment. And Brian has been following some boycotts by, I guess, teachers objecting to testing, right?
Yeah, it seems to be a culture of rebellion in the country against standardized testing in some way.
I see.
Someone
said that your hair is a manifestation physically of a rebellion of some kind from your point of view.
That means it's going to keep growing then, you know. And yes, it is a rebellion.
All right,
against gravity.
So what happened in these places? Seattle?
Seattle, they started last year by boycotting what is known as the Measure of Academic Progress test, which is called MAP. And the test itself, they said that it didn't really capture what their curriculum was,
right.
So they didn't want to teach it.
So this
they didn't want to test people on
at
it.
At a particular school, I guess, where they're saying, is it a particular school, or do I have this story confused with the other one in Chicago?
This is the story, it's a couple of different schools, not just one.
Right, but nevertheless, they say by boycotting, they're refusing to administer their state tests, Measures of Academic Progress test. And they're saying that, they've threatened the teachers with a 10-day suspension, but when several schools joined the boycott, apparently the district backed off and killed this requirement. I see. All right. And it says, next year, the district looks likely to battle teachers again over standardized tests.
Of course.
This time, Common Core related.
Absolutely. And that's the thing. It's Common Core related.
I mean,
Common Core is continuing to be, you know, the redheaded stepchild, the elephant in the room.
Right.
And any test that is centered around that is definitely going to get some backlash.
This is the part, actually, that I was thinking about. This is the Chicago story. It says here, boycott teachers. This is a Common Dreams. It's a progressive website, but it says, teachers take bold stand against insatiable data monster.
Yes.
Putting careers on the line. Chicago elementary teachers vote yes to teaching, but no to useless testing. And they say 40 teachers here in a particular elementary school have voted without dissent to refuse administration of the Illinois Standard Achievement Test, the ISAT, an achievement test given across the state. We are not afraid, they say. We're standing strong for our kids and what is right. We will not give them these tests.
And they've gone so far as to actually, there are kids that are signing waivers to opt out, and they're not showing up to school for these tests.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we'll see what the district does when these teachers there say, we're not going to do it, right?
Absolutely.
All right. So, nevertheless, you also have a story about, I guess, is Mike Pence the governor of Indiana next for you?
Indiana Governor Mike Pence spent yesterday trying to breathe life back into a preschool voucher plan that the state Senate rejected. Pence visited an Indianapolis preschool for four-year-olds housed at the Shepherd Community Center, praising the work of the school and advocating for the voucher plan.
There are children that start kindergarten without access to programs like this, and they start school not ready to learn.
The director of the community center, Sana Dumas, told WRTV Channel 6 that the vouchers would benefit parents.
I've had many parents in my office this year just sharing, and there's a great need, and not only for tuition money, but also for things that they need in their homes, transportation to and from school.
While the preschool voucher proposal sailed through the Indiana House of Representatives last month with bipartisan support, it was rejected by the Senate Education Committee. Robert Antlow, president of the Friedman Foundation for Educational Choice, who supports the vouchers, explains why the Senate killed it.
Yeah, my take from watching the conversation in the Senate was, we want to study it more, and it's got fiscal implications that we're not sure of. And the Senate is trying to do its senatorial thing, as it always does. Unfortunately, that's the wrong way to look at it, because this isn't new money. This would be money that's coming from the previous budget. And so one has to ask yourself, why did the Senate Education Committee kill it?
Parents like Jenny Izagire told local TV cameras that school choice for pre-K children makes sense to her.
The voucher gives the opportunity to decide which school we want for our kids.
I think the time is now to start a voluntary pre-K scholarship program for our most disadvantaged children.
I'm sure Governor Pence will continue to sell this program and try and get it in front of the public. You know, early childhood education is supported across the state.
It's an odd political dynamic in Indiana, right? Where the House passed these pre-K vouchers, and then the Senate came along, and mostly the Republicans killed it.
Yeah, that's the surprising part.
You figure
they want some kind of any kind of school choice to move forward in legislation, but they wanted something more test-oriented.
The thing is, Neil, I'm often skeptical of, you know, younger and younger kids all getting government-paid educations. We need fourth-year-olds, then now we need three-year-olds. Pretty soon it'll be two-year-olds, and, you know, then in utero or something. Like, so when you hear pre-K vouchers, I don't know, I'm torn. It's, how do you react?
Yeah, I'm torn, too. I don't know whether Indiana was taking money that was already going to pre-K and voucherizing it, but if this is something new, this is a very bad thing. And the reality is, pre-K sounds good to people. You know, you take three-year-olds, four-year-olds, you think you're giving them good nutrition, good education,
right,
really getting ready. But the research simply doesn't bear out that these pre-K programs work. And a big part of the problem is you have people, these centers will take money, but they don't really provide decent services. So it is something I think we need to be very hesitant about. And just because there's a voucher that's part of it doesn't make it good.
Now, do you apply that level of scrutiny? You say they don't apply decent services. What do you say about a private high school that takes voucher money? Are you as skeptical of the decent services for a different age kid?
Yeah, well, I'm always skeptical, and I'm always skeptical if somebody was paying for something with someone else's money. That's one of the reasons that I say that if you're going to have voucher programs, part of it should be requiring that the family that gets that voucher also pay something. Because there's research that shows if you're using some of your own money, you're much more likely to care about the quality.
Okay.
And that said, there is a difference in that pre-K is often used, we're told that it's there to to build your cognitive and social emotional characteristics, but it's often used just as daycare for little kids.
Yes,
and
yes.
So we're not getting what we think out of it. Whereas high school, yes, can sort of be daycare for bigger kids, I guess, sometimes. But
indeed.
There's a lot more motivation to use it well.
Yes,
right.
Absolutely. That's right. And actually, Chris Christie early on got in trouble for calling it babysitting when he was running for governor. And in fact, when the recent government shutdown happened in Washington, D.C., the press went, and the stories I read from the Washington Post were interviewing people who decried not the lack of education that their four-year-old would be getting, but what do I do for daycare now? I got to go to work. And, that's how these programs were sold. They were talking about Head Start in that case. And they weren't sold as daycare, but that's how then once they were pulled away with the government shutdown, that's how they explained that this was a terrible thing. So I want to go to Heather now. Heather, I understand from the question of pre-K vouchers to kids with beer. It's not a transition we see every day, but tell us what happened in Texas.
In Texas, there was a 17-year-old named Chaz Seal who accidentally brought a beer into school instead of a soda with his lunch.
Now, we might laugh and guffaw when you say a 17-year-old accidentally had a beer. Like, what do you mean?
Well, here's the crazy thing. He actually handed the beer directly to a teacher and explained the mistake that he had made in hopes of avoiding any problems and staying out of trouble.
All right. So then what happens?
Instead, he got into a pretty hefty amount of trouble. The school administrators suspended him for 3 days, told him he would have to attend an alternative school for 2 months, and he was also cited. He actually received a ticket for having alcohol within his possession.
Wow.
So he voluntarily turns in this beer.
Yes.
And he gets
in trouble as if he was, drinking a six-pack in the middle of class.
Right. That is indeed a remark. It seems like an overreaction,
so
but I guess you have these choices.
He would have been better off if he just hid the beer.
Well,
or drank the beer.
Drank it.
Unfortunately, that's the message that seems to be being sent by the no tolerance policy that the school is enforcing.
All right, so what's going on with the Utah virtual charters?
The Utah virtual charters, there was an audit done by the state Board of Education that identified two companies who were apparently making millions of dollars in taxpayer money for recruiting children to virtual charter schools.
Okay.
But the claim made in the audit is that these companies are basically lying or misleading, saying that students who are only taking a few classes online are actually enrolled as full-time students. So more funding is being allocated to cover full-time students.
The discrepancy is over how you define whether the student is taking is actually enrolled in an online charter or not, right?
Yes.
If they take the company defined it, I guess, based on the letter of the law, and meanwhile the state audit was kind of looking at the spirit of the law, something like that. If I'm a kid, I opt out of regular public school, I sign up for the virtual charter, and I take one course and maybe half do one course, maybe based on the law they get the full payment for that, and the auditors are saying, hey, this is a ripoff.
Yeah, that's exactly what's happening. Senator Deidre Henderson is calling them ghost students, basically claiming that the schools in question don't manage or interact with the students.
Uh-huh.
It's a sum of $10.5 million going to Harmony Education Services and My Tech High. The presidents, the leaders of both of those companies, are denying any wrongdoing and also claiming that if the state wants to come up with clearer standards, then they'll be more than happy to comply.
Okay. We've heard about this, Neil, before. K-12 gotten in some trouble. It's been alleged that they sometimes charge more than they ought to be for online services. What do you make of this stuff? Whitney Tilson, of course, has, done all he can to throw his weight against K-12, et cetera.
Yeah, these things are always hard to tell what's really going on unless you really are in that situation. You've seen all the documents, because it's quite possible that there are schools that will charge for students they know they don't have, or they're charging more of the education they're providing. But you also know there's a political component for prosecutions of these sorts of schools. And even if you don't think they're guilty, you might prosecute them for purely political reasons to get a headline. So it's hard to tell, but it is an inherent problem of a charter school where the money goes from the state to the school rather than it goes right through the students. And again, this is why it's really important if you're going to have an arrangement like this, those families need to be paying something too. So they actually stand to lose something if they do something fraudulent or go to a bad school.
Heather, your package of the day pertains to Michigan.
Are we skipping the Connecticut story?
Oh, well, I don't want to skip the Connecticut story. Yeah. I stand corrected. Go ahead. Please tell us this. How could I have skipped this one? Go ahead.
Okay. In Connecticut, a substitute teacher was arrested for being caught masturbating in a stairwell while leering at students in a courtyard.
I'm sorry. Right.
He's about 71, 72 years old. And a teacher's assistant originally thought that he was injured and on the ground, but when she inspected further, she realized that his pants were open and he was in a state of arousal.
Okay. This is a 72-year-old substitute teacher caught masturbating in a stairwell in a high school, is it?
Yes.
In Connecticut. Okay.
Yeah, West Hill High School in Stamford, Connecticut.
All right.
And as soon as the woman realized what was happening, she started screaming, and the man fled back to the classroom he was supposed to be substituting in, because, you know, that's a really great place to hide out, obviously. So the school resource officers escorted him to the main office. He was arrested. He's facing several charges.
Sure. And the tweet here is, just to zoom in on this a bit, saying, well, if he makes bond, he'll be monitored. So they're trying to, I guess, reassure the parents. All right, so I now feel that we have covered this story sufficiently. Well, I'm not even going to ask Neal about this. I'm actually kind of almost horrified that we even brought up the whole question at all. But that's,
I'm impressed how you ramp it up from beer to, you
know, more from beer. Oh, we keep it classy at Choice Media. Don't ever forget that.
Exactly. Now, Heather. Now that we have the, shall I say, Connecticut story out of the way, we can now talk about the Michigan story that was your package. What was it?
Yes, there's a teacher in Michigan who is being heavily criticized for taking a cell phone video of herself teasing an autistic child. A video of a Michigan teacher went viral yesterday after she recorded herself teasing an autistic child whose head and shoulders were stuck in a chair. Nicole McVeigh, the teacher, can be heard on the clip asking the student if he wants to be tasered.
Do you want to get tasered?
The principal, Michael Ellis, can be heard speaking off camera, saying the school's maintenance department doesn't consider the matter to be an emergency. Parents defended the teacher at a school board meeting.
She is very compassionate. She has taught the children compassion. She has taught them how to accept others. She loves the children. She is a very good teacher. She would never jeopardize or bully anyone. And there was no incidents whatsoever where that teacher bullied that student. Yes, she had a sense of humor, and she tried to make light of the situation.
Despite support from parents, the board still voted to fire the teacher, Ms. McVeigh, but she's fighting to keep her job. The principal has resigned. The story led local news programs across the state of Michigan.
Tonight in the community of Goodrich, controversial video of a student with Asperger's syndrome, a form of autism, trapped in a classroom chair.
A teacher videotaped one of her elementary students with his body stuck in his chair.
But the teacher is still employed by that district.
It's video no parent wants to see, an 11-year-old autistic child with his head stuck in a classroom chair.
While the teacher was defended in the board meeting, social media responses were not so kind. Twitterer Sean Lay wrote, "Taxpayer paid leave for Michigan teacher Nicole McVeigh. How about arresting Nicole McVeigh?" And also on Twitter, Jamie Wright, who happens to go by the handle @BrokenIcon, posted, "Not going to abuse Nicole McVeigh for neglect of an autistic student. Going to wish her luck in the future role as unemployable teacher instead."
And so, Neal, we want to say stories like this, of course, any kind of school, any kind of human endeavor, you can have individuals who mess up, right? So that could be private school, charter school, district school. It's not like finding an anecdote of an individual teacher tells you anything in particular about a system. That said, there are things to point out, like they're trying to fire this teacher, and they can't. They haven't done it yet. They want to, but she's just going through this tenure process, and, you know, who knows how long it'll be. And then there's also the other point of, like, you know, we don't really know this teacher's work, and so one incident that where no one's really injured and it just takes a few minutes out of an entire career may not be justification to fire. I mean, you know, I don't want to pretend like I know that that I would want to fire her if I were on a school board or a principal. So anyway, so there's all that. But when you hear these kinds of stories, what goes through your head?
Yeah, the first thing I think is, well, what aren't we seeing in the videos? What don't we know about what happened? It's something that's really important to be in that classroom. And I think it is important and interesting that you hear some parents saying, look, we know this is a good teacher. The problem ultimately that I think from a public policy standpoint is the decision about what's going to be made about this teacher is going to be probably blunt for one of two reasons, or for possibly two reasons. One, the teacher contract might say even if she's terrible, she should be impossible to fire. On the flip side, people calling for her to be fired might just say, I saw this video, I think it's terrible, and I assume she's bad. And we really don't want a system where decisions are made with such blunt instruments. That's, again, why school choice is so important, where people can say, look, you're a school that stays in business because I pay for it, and I know this teacher's good, I'm not going to leave, or I know she's bad,
right,
and this is the last straw.
Meaning that common sense, when there's a marketplace, common sense decisions by a bunch of individuals can make a lot, be a much better way to run a system than a bureaucracy with rigid rules of when you can fire and how many appeals it takes every time, whether the case is egregious or the case is minor. A system with rigidity tends to function less in a, you know, when problems emerge, than a system that's flexible and trusts individuals on the ground.
I mean, it's really important that the decisions be made by the people who are closest to the school. And if there are lots of different opinions on it, you want those to be expressed where they're all kind of equal. And that is people coming, people going, and taking money to or from that school. But unfortunately, situations like this come up, and it's either an immediate knee-jerk reaction based on the film that people have seen, or on the flip side, it's no reaction because you have these teacher contracts that make it so hard to get rid of people who are even egregiously bad.
And before we finish today, Heather, there's a calendar. We have a Choice Media calendar. People may not know, but go ahead and tell us what calendar event are you looking at. In fact, actually, let me show the viewers first, Chris, if you don't mind. So the Choice Media calendar here, the only Ed Reform event calendar like it on the web. Clicking here, we see the month of February, and what's the item you wanted to promote?
March 7th, there's a webinar on using transitional coursework in high school to improve college success. It's going to be run by Education Week, and
okay,
it'll discuss recent developments in helping students prepare for college.
Okay, Education Week webinar for March 7th, and more than anything, we want to thank Neal McCluskey for being our guest on today's Reform School Program by Choice Media. Thanks, Neal.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks, everyone else, and thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.